Do you want to make a difference in the world?
And see the lives of the people of India and all internationals transformed with the gospel?
As India goes, all Asia will go with.
Living the Dream podcast provides tools for you to pray, give, and go
as you become an active participant in the Great Commission.
And help your church's demographic represent the demographic of your community.
Get ready to find your strategy for reaching your community and changing the world here at Living the Dream podcast with your host, Pastor Kevin.
Good morning. I'm Pastor Kevin, founder and executive director of Global Hope India, and your host for Living the Dream podcast. This is where the church gathers to mobilize in order to effectively reach the community and change the world, including all the foreign-born internationals moving into our communities. I interview today's top church leaders from around the world so we can learn all we can about reaching internationals with the gospel and partnering with them in the Great Commission. It's time the church has this conversation. Go to globalhopeindia.org/resources for tools for your success. Now, let's jump into today's show. I want to give you some context in case you missed it. You'll want to go to last week's episode and catch part one of a two-part interview with Pastor Stephen Furtick of Elevation Church in Charlotte, North Carolina, when he sat down for a conversation of solidarity with Pastor John Gray of Relentless Church in Greenville, South Carolina. Pastor Stephen is Caucasian. Pastor John is African American. They are world-renowned leaders in the church, and they dearly love each other and express that in their conversation. This is a conversation of solidarity as a result of the brutal and unjust murder of George Floyd, a 46-year-old black man who was brutally murdered in the hands of four white police officers. The medical examiner has concluded that George Floyd's death was a homicide. Millions of people around the USA and the world have been protesting for justice in a global display of solidarity. On Sunday, May the 31st, Pastor Stephen and Pastor John sat down for this humble and grace-filled conversation where they wept together and committed together to be a voice for the voiceless. In part two, I encourage you to lean in as they discuss how the purpose of unity is not uniformity. They share with us that we're not going to agree on everything, but they share that they are going to fight for one another until the day they die. Let's listen in on the conversation between Pastor Stephen Furtick and Pastor John Gray.
My view of church was kind of informed by Santee Circle Baptist Mission, where Pastor Mickey let me come be the youth pastor, kind of informed by Monk's Corner United Methodist, where I grew up, and then kind of informed by Voices of Unity, the gospel choir that Chris Dixon invited and recruited me to sing in. I went to go see the spring concert for Voices of Unity, and I loved it so much because I was looking for new music because I was trying to burn all my secular music, you know, my secular CDs. I was having a bonfire for my Green Day CDs and all that. And to me, somebody had slipped me a Kirk Franklin tape and a John P. Key tape. And I liked it enough to ask Chris Dixon, when was the spring concert? And I came to the concert, and then he asked me to join the choir the next year. And I said, you don't really want me to join. I'd be the only white person in the Voices of Unity choir. He said, I'd love for you to join. I want you to join. And I blew him off, and I was kind of thinking he was just being polite, but he kept chasing me down. He said, our first rehearsal is Wednesday in the band room. I want you there. I need you in my tenor section. And his mom, Martha Dixon, was the sponsor of the choir. And I spent that year, my senior year of high school, singing with that choir, and being welcome, being the only white person in every church we went into to sing. And it shaped so much of who I was that when I went to college, they had a gospel choir called Black Student Fellowship. I joined that one too.
I love this.
And And that one changed the name.
This explains so much about you.
BSF was Black Student Fellowship, but then it was Brothers and Sisters Fellowship for the 2 years that I was there because I was so...
You messed up the name.
I was so determined to be in the choir. Yeah, changed the name. So that's not to say I've always been down, you know? That's not what I'm saying. I'm saying so much of me was shaped. So when Elevation Church was born, it was mostly white people. I never saw that. I never saw that this would just be a white church, black church, brown church. I never saw that it would just be for the people that believe in predestination or that believe in pre-tribulation rapture. I never saw that. I just saw that we would probably encompass a lot of different backgrounds. I always saw it that way. And I was telling this guy, TJ, I'll say for short, remember him? And I told him, I'm going to start a church, and I believe it's going to be really diverse, and I believe it's going to have all kinds of people, black people, white people, young people, all that, you know. And he goes, not in the South, you won't. Not in the South, you won't.
Wow. Help me, Jesus.
Well, in the South, we did. You know, in the South, we did. Like, please don't limit my God to your experience. Like, please don't bring my God down to the level of your frame of reference. You know? And I never got to bring that guy to Elevation. I really wish he could come and I could show him what God did. But it wasn't a strategy. It wasn't,
thank you.
You know, oh well, if we'll get a black singer and a white singer and a female singer, there was never any of that. It was invested in me from the people who welcomed me.
Wow.
And so it's impossible for me now to not want to sit down with you and say, I can't receive from a culture. I can't receive from a community and then not share in the pain of the people who make up that community.
That's right.
To me, that's sin. To me, that's missing the mark.
Yes, sir.
And to me, that's falling short of the standard that God has given the church. And so when people say, how do you diversify Elevation Church? You know, how do you diversify? I'm like, well, first you have to go to the Voices of Unity concert and realize that Martha Dixon does not sing Pass Me Not, O Gentle Savior the same way that they sang it at Monk's Corner United Methodist. It's a completely different rhythm, a completely different cadence. It's a completely different thing. First, you are going to have to expose yourself. I think exposure is so critical.
Absolutely.
Because, listen, if I were taking my view of people that don't look like me from what I see in headlines and what I see that is presented to me from CNN or Fox News, if I were to reduce it down to that, it would kill my ability to empathize with the humanity of that person. The only reason I know to have this conversation with you is because of your friendship to me. If you didn't give me the gift of your lens to let me know what actually happens in your neighborhood. But see, I can't have a black couple that sits on the front row of my Sunday 9:30 every week email me and say, pray for us, it's been a hard week, that my husband had the police called on him for taking out the trash too late at night in our neighborhood and refuse to feel that and celebrate. We're a diverse church. Blessed are the peacemakers. Pull the string and let Jesus say something to ignore the issue that is really beneath.
Jesus.
To me, that would be the essence of hypocrisy. But a lot of people don't get to have conversations like this, or they won't, or they're scared they'll say it wrong, or they don't want to take the time, or they don't want to know, or they'll just say, well, I could never understand. Well, you need to start understanding because it's real.
That's it.
And avoiding it won't make it go away. So we've got to start understanding. We've got to start reading. We've got to start learning some things, exposing some things. You know, the light of the world. Jesus said, you are the light of the world. I always thought that meant, you know, quote scriptures and witness to people. It means don't be ignorant. It means we've got to shine light on ignorance.
That's right.
We've got to have revelation about things that we don't understand. Just because I haven't experienced it doesn't mean it doesn't exist.
That's it. And when, please, can we just take... Steve-O, your experience with the BSF choir, Brothers and Sisters Fellowship, Black Student Fellowship, whatever the name was that had to change because you showed up. That's a beautiful thing because your presence changed the system. And your presence changes the system. And it's why God had you in those places, because he knew you were going to need to sit in that chair in 2020. And you're not pandering. You've lived it. And this is the power of the moment, that I didn't try to be someone who's trying to build bridges. I've had to build them. The problem with people who build bridges is when you lay yourself down, they walk all over you. And they often don't see your value until it's over. I told you personally, I said, I don't really think things will change either until somebody like me gets killed. I said it to my wife. I hope it doesn't happen. I want to live. I want to walk my daughter down the aisle. But it takes somebody like that to die. So somebody said, this can't keep going. But it was organic. Your connection to the communities that you would end up pastoring was organic. And then it became intentional. Because I do believe that there is an intentionality to continuing the conversations around diversity. And in the church, we have run the other way. After Brown versus Topeka, the proliferation of Christian schools, which was a nice way of saying, I don't want my white kids going to school with black kids, so I'm gonna put Jesus in front of it and call it a Christian school, put a tuition on it, and not let my kids go to school with these black kids. That's where that happened. The Baptists and Southern Baptists, the issue that separated them was the Southern Baptists wanted to keep their slaves. Southern Baptist, Southern Christian. We see Jesus is okay with us owning other humans. So let's keep singing What a Friend We Have in Jesus while owning people. And so when you think about the silence of the church, and somebody asked me, how come you think more white pastors don't speak out? And I said, because it'll mess up their money. It'll mess up their tithe because they have too many people who think opposite of justice, not race, just justice, just humanity. And they're afraid. And I think that's why God wants to tear it all down. The first thing Jesus did in the last week of his life was turn over the table of the money changers. So this is not about money. If you're afraid you're going to lose tithe because you speak out against injustice, maybe you shouldn't be pastoring right now. If you don't care about the humanity of somebody dying on the street. And here's the thing, if it was a white woman with a black cop on her neck, I'd still be on this stage, because that is as wrong as Big Floyd dying. This is not about color for me. This is about systemic oppression of people in power that are supposed to protect and serve. And that's years in the making. And again, this is the silence of the church that must be addressed. This conversation is the beginning of something that I think more churches need to have. It's so much that I want to say, but I know this is...
I was thinking before we came, I wish that the church could be full. I wish we could be together, because this week has been so lonely for so many people. And to process in church together would be beautiful. But then I shifted and I thought, I'm glad that the conversation will be happening in homes. That
perfect.
Hundreds of thousands of people will be experiencing this conversation in their home, because if the conversation happens in the home.
Yes, Stephen Furtick, you better preach.
I looked at Elijah when he said, it's hopeless. I said, if I gave into that, I'd be sacrificing an entire generation and I would have no reason to ever stand up and preach again. So I refuse to submit to that. I refuse to surrender to darkness. I'm not ready to do that
yet. Come on.
At the same time, like, to think that one person's life, mind, heart would change, not just feel guilty. I think that's stopping well short of what's really going to bring about any change. Like, guilt is not a strategy. You know, oh, I feel so bad about that, and I'm white, and I don't know what it's like to be black, and I feel so bad. You know, broken heart emoji, I feel horrible. Guilt is not a strategy. But maybe we don't know the difference between guilt and repentance. Because I've never talked to a black friend or someone who goes to church here who is black that said, what I want you to do is feel bad.
That's right.
Would you just feel bad for me? Would you just feel bad about things? Feeling bad doesn't change anything. But repentance is different than guilt. Repentance means change direction. in the Old Testament,
right,
and change your mind in the New Testament.
Yes, sir.
And so it means we change direction. We do it differently. We have to do it differently. We have to do this differently than we've been doing it, or we're going to continue to see this, and then we're going to feel bad, and then we're going to see it, and then we're going to feel bad. The only way to break the cycle is to repent. And we were talking on the phone about we can't just come out, sit down, and wash each other's feet and sing A Bridge Over Troubled Waters and pass it on, light candles and kumbaya, because, you know, at the end of the day, that would just be nothing but an anesthetic. But to really repent in your heart and say, have I changed my mind? Do I see things like God sees it, or do I still allow in my heart these corners of darkness that I make assumptions and that I allow prejudice and I excuse it? Do I allow those conversations? Do I participate in them? Do I advocate them? Do I co-sign them by my silence? That's repentance. Repentance is changing direction. Repentance is moving differently, thinking differently, speaking differently, refusing to contribute by indifference.
Yeah.
So I think the better biblical response to this is repent, which isn't lay on the floor and just cry. It's to get up and walk in a different direction.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. When you talk about changing direction, the questions that I think white people need to be asking themselves in this moment, what is in my heart about Black people, and how did it get there?
Great.
Because there are people who say, I'm cool with everybody. How cool are you? Are you cool enough to let your white daughter marry a Black man? Oh, yeah, that's no problem. What about your mom? Would she be okay with it? Aunts and uncles. I know Abby and John are about a year apart, my son, your daughter. I hope they grow up together worshiping God with the amazing Graves in the Gardens box set. And, you know, first of all, I'm so sick of you writing bangers. I'm really tired of it. And I want to sit in the writing room with you, but enough about that. But would they be okay? Charlotte, they'd probably be cool. But if they were walking down the street in Monk's Corner just as friends, would somebody have a problem? If they were sitting in a diner, would your family be okay with that? We need to start asking those questions. That's why this conversation needs to be at home, because it's one thing to be nice to me here, but how many N-words am I at your house? How many H-words are white people in my house? Mm-hmm. See, because it goes both ways. I don't want to see, because what we can't do here is absolve any community from responsibility. If we're going to really have healing, then we need to deal with the anger and the pain on one side and the indifference and apathy on the other. There is responsibility. I don't get to use my pain as a pulpit to get angry at every white person when there are some areas of collective responsibility that I need to take. But on the other side, if we're really going to change our minds, we need to be honest about what's in there in the first place and how it got there.
And how it got there.
And how it got there.
We want to give some local love to the award-winning team at Mako Medical, one of the most desired laboratories in the United States, with the quickest turnaround time in the industry and one of the fastest growing companies in the Triangle region of North Carolina. We recognize their CEO, Chad Price, for his public witness for Christ and corporate practice of generosity. Mako is known for its extensive community service, supporting over 470 local nonprofits and charities, as well as Christian missionaries around the world and proud employers of military veterans. Check out their website at makomedical.com.
Help turn Kevin's new book, Audacious Generosity, into a reality.
Are you ready to move?
This global pandemic has brought the whole world to a screeching halt. Rest assured, God is on the move. Aren't you glad Jesus is an ever-present help in time of need? What about people far from God? Where do they turn in the midst of these global challenges? God has a plan named Jesus.
I believe God's strategy has always been audacious generosity.
For God so loved the world that he gave Jesus. Audacious generosity is where you allow God to be kind and plentiful through you. As believers, we have the richest, most generous person in the world living inside of us.
Are you ready to move?
I want to invite you to join me in a movement of audacious generosity, a movement where God is the giver and giving depends on what God gives through you. A movement where we don't just read about the miracles in the Bible, like the feeding of the multitude, but we witness modern day miracles in our own hands. A movement where believers around the world unite to fulfill the Great Commission.
A movement where you experience, receive, and give more than you ever thought possible. Are you ready to move?
God led me to write Audacious Generosity just for you. It's a timely message and response to these global challenges.
I'm Kevin White. I would like for you to be a backer by pledging your support. Funds will be used to publish Audacious Generosity, making it available on Amazon and around the world.
Join me to launch a movement the world is literally dying to see.
Are you ready to move?
Check it out now at globalhopeindia.org/book. That's globalhopeindia.org/book. Thanks for pledging your support. Know your numbers. Maybe you've seen the show Shark Tank, and you've seen the business owners come in to pitch to the sharks and explain why they're the right person to execute the vision for their business. Well, we believe that you are the right person to execute the vision for your church, and you need to know your numbers.
Did you know that there are 2 times more Asian internationals than there are Hispanic internationals living in the USA today? Did you know that Indian nationals have increased 500% since 1990? Today, foreign-born internationals account for 13.6% of the U.S. population. That's nearly triple since 1970, when it was only 4.7%. So if more than 1 out of every 10 person living in the USA today is a foreign-born international, this is a reason and opportunity for the church today to know our numbers and to get comfortable reaching our international friends. The more you know the numbers of what God is doing here in the USA and bringing foreign-born internationals to live here, the more it should encourage you to have an identifiable and measurable strategy for reaching these international friends living in your community.
And we get to affect that, because that's the idea that I have. If we change one person's heart and mind, if God changes one person's heart and mind through this conversation today, or even if we can model, like, this needs to happen at the kitchen table. This needs to happen not only as a token conversation in a moment that is as flagrant as the moment that we're in, but it should be a course of conversation for followers of Christ that really permeates our lives. And that's why somebody will always say, "That's fine, you're talking, but what are you doing about it?" And I've given my life to try to build something that represented more than just one group of people. At the same time, John, there has to be more than just words. So if we say this conversation is a start, but it's not a solution, what's in your heart that you want to see people do from watching us talk today? Do, not just say, do, not just think, do, not just post. What do you really want to see people do?
I want this conversation to begin to be the tipping point for the church to have the necessary conversations around true reconciliation, one to another, according to John 17, because if we don't have the presence of God in the conversation and in our hearts, then empathy and compassion and activism won't matter. What I want is for this to begin the necessary dialogue that we need to have with one another. And then we need to have real world application in real time when we see injustice and systemic injustice on the local, regional, and national levels, to mobilize and everybody move in that direction towards that. Once that's done, then let's go in another direction. We've been talking about the bridge since 2018. There's a website that's live right now as of this moment called Become the Bridge. And all I'm saying is, if everybody would go there, just go to Become the Bridge And if you want to be a part of the solution, we're going to have, here's the thing. We're going to teach people, because there are a lot of people who genuinely don't know what's been going on. Right. And so it's one thing to be angry or prejudiced. It's another thing to be apathetic because you don't know. So let's talk about what's really going on and let's have conversation, because I need to know your experience as well. See, because that helps me to understand how you arrived at your conclusions about people. And you need to know where I come from. Strangest thing, in Greenville, South Carolina, I pastor a multicultural, multigenerational church. I can see why Black people would follow you. It's organic. It's also ingrained in the system that Black people connect to white leaders in a different way than white people connect to Black leaders. Understood. So it's a miracle that any white person goes to my church in the middle of the South. And that's a testimony to God. But the conversation needs to be, how do we all meet on this bridge? And what is the purpose of unity? Unity is not uniformity. We're not going to agree on everything, but I'm going to fight for you until I die. And Elijah and Graham and Abby are going to have an uncle in me. And it doesn't mean that I have the same bloodline as you, but I do have the same spiritual lineage as you. And I'm going to fight for them to have the same level of quality of life that I want for my own children. And so us having this conversation is coming from our safe zone, stepping onto the bridge and saying, let's have the uncomfortable initial conversation and let's invite family in. But then let's start having the ability to talk online. And then here's a worksheet so you can talk through some of these areas. And then later, let's get some systemic issues like redlining and credit worthiness and the ability to get a small business loan, which is easier for some than others. Let's talk about that, because it's not just about you don't like me because I'm Black and I don't like you because you're white. I'm hurting because I can't get a loan and you can with the same credit score and the same tax returns. But because of the color of my skin, I don't have access to credit or capital. Some of this is systemic, some of it is monetary, but all of it is rooted spiritually. So the website, Become the Bridge, is a place where we can have the first conversation. Then we're going to mobilize from there. And in every single region, we're going to lift up people who have empathy, compassion, and a heart for diversity, true inclusion, not this soft kumbaya. It doesn't work. But I need to be able to feel your pain, and I need you to be able to feel my pain. That's the compassion that Jesus spoke about. He's like, you give them something to eat. They were like, we don't have enough money. He's like, you feed them. He was exhausted after preaching all day. He had compassion and healed them all. He was always talking about compassion. That means I empathize with the hunger and the pain of the people who have no voice. They are lost. He was always compassionate. The prostitute at the Pharisee's house, he had compassion. The woman that was caught in adultery, he had compassion. He was always messing up systems. The Samaritan at the well, compassion. She didn't come from his background. He had compassion. Syrophoenician woman, the leper who you aren't supposed to touch. He had compassion. And if we're really going to be the church, then we need to be a church that has compassion on the modern day lepers of systemic racism and the victims of systemic social injustice and the racism that has existed in the church and the prejudice and the pain that it has produced on both sides. We need to meet in the middle, and then we all need to look up to the cross, because until that blood gets on our minds, it won't get in our hearts and it won't get in our hands and nothing will change. Beautiful. Sorry, I didn't mean to hit your nice chair.
It's a sturdy chair.
It is.
Hit it again. See?
What is this, Restoration Heart? Where
that's hit it as hard as you want.
Now it hurts.
I want us to pray. And I would love it if you would pray. But I don't just want us to pray on this stage. I want everybody watching to just take a moment and kind of like create a little bit of a space and bow your head and close your eyes. And if there's anything else that you want to minister before you pray, it's great. But as we're getting set to pray, I want to thank you. It can't be easy to say these kinds of things when you know how many different perspectives there will be on what you said, but you've never been afraid to say them. And thank you today for the gift of your perspective and your wisdom. I've never had a friend more brilliant than you, but also I want to thank you for not being so brilliant that you forget how to help us feel. And I think sometimes we become so numb that we don't feel anything anymore. And I want you to pray for the people who feel overwhelmed and they feel like, I can't do anything, so I don't want to do anything. I can't do everything, so I don't want to do anything. And I want you to pray for the people who have been blind to this, that God would open their eyes. And also minister anything else that you want to minister in these closing moments.
I love you. I'm grateful for your life. I'm grateful for your heart. The text that they will never see, the things that I send you to just speak life into you, to let you know how important you are to the kingdom of God. I meant them then. I mean them now. I'm grateful that I get to live at the same time as you. I'm the biggest cheerleader of what God is doing at Elevation Church, because it is breaking the back of the devil that has existed in this region of the country for hundreds of years. And I hope to God that you live long enough to see the fruit through Graham and Elijah and Abby and John and Theory. I'm grateful for your encouragement to me and the Relentless family when many people walked away at the brokenness of moments that I knew were coming because I knew what was in me. And God sent you to speak life to me at some of the most difficult and challenging moments of my life. I want to thank you for being a friend, not a white friend, but my friend. And now we're having a conversation that most people would be afraid to have. You got a lot to lose if it goes wrong. And you cared enough about the voiceless and the nameless and the faceless and the black kids in the hood of Charlotte and all over where your campuses are and the global family and the shanty towns of South Africa. You cared enough to let them know that I see you and you matter, and that their soul was more important than your platform. I thank God for you. And for Big Floyd's family and Ahmaud Arbery, Breonna Taylor, and Alton Sterling and Sandra Bland and Tamira Rice, and Trayvon Martin, and for so many black bodies that have died because of injustice and apathy and a lack of human empathy. I'm grateful that this moment has begun, and I pray that the church will not turn a blinded eye to this conversation. I was always the guy running to build bridges between the black church and the white church, hoping that they would receive me, hoping that they would understand who I was. And for a moment there, I was so busy building bridges that a part of me forgot that I am black. And if things go wrong, I'll die in the street and they won't care. I'll just be wet teddy bears and old flowers and melted candles on the side of a road. But I'm more than a preacher. I'm a man. I'm a black man. And my life matters. And it is equal to the value of every other life in this nation and the world. Yes, all lives matter. But this black life, it matters. And George's life matters. And the people who didn't get an opportunity for justice, their lives matter as well. And my prayer is that you will have compassion and empathy in this moment for the pain of people who have never had anyone to advocate for them. May the church be a voice to the voiceless. And may you feel something. Go back and look at the video. And if something doesn't move in your heart, ask the Holy Spirit to give you a heart of flesh instead of a heart of stone. Because if you can watch anyone die and feel nothing, then I'm certain that the heartbeat of Jesus is not yet fully activated in you. And my prayer is that the black church and the white church will take black and white off of the front and just become the church, that we will live in community and fight for the unity of the spirit and the bond of peace, pursue peace with all men and holiness without which no man shall see the Lord. May God touch our hearts, prick us to a heart of action. And may unity in the body of Christ be a hill we are willing to die on. I've made my decision. I'm willing to step into a bullet and in front of a bullet so that Stephen can live. And I believe that if the same were happening to me, he'd do the same. because that's what it may cost to see true unity. But I pray that no more bodies have to be on the ground. I pray that no more cities have to burn. I pray that no more black mothers feel closer to Jesus because they lost their only begotten son too. My prayer is that the pain is enough for you to now effectuate change. But change is not your actions. Change starts in your heart. And so, God, I pray right now by the power of the Holy Spirit and in the name of Jesus that you will take this initial conversation and prick our hearts. And if my people who are called by my name, that was an admonition to the church. If the church will do what it needs to do, I'll heal the entirety of the land. But I'm reconciling this issue through the church. Because true heart change comes from the presence of the Holy Spirit, found most perfectly in the person of Jesus. And so may we have a relentless moment of elevated consciousness. Elevate us, God. And may we pursue justice relentlessly. May we celebrate our differences while attacking at its root the systems of oppression and the spirit of injustice that has ruled the day. May we change our hearts by seeing each other as equally valuable. God, give us hope, give us peace, give us strength. Show us the pathway. This is my prayer. Your brown son and your white son ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
You've listened to the conversation between Pastor Stephen Furtick and Pastor John Gray. I love how they share that the church has to be a voice for the voiceless, that if there is a black church and a white church, it is time to take the black and the white off the front and just be the Big C church, the church of the Lord Jesus Christ, as we live in community and fight for unity of the spirit with the bond of peace. I love how they call us to pursue peace with all men and holiness, without which no man shall see the Lord. I love how they affirm that God would touch our hearts and prick our hearts to action, and how they commit that unity and the body of Christ will be the hill that they are willing to die on. They are putting on public display their decision, and even going as far as saying that they would step into a bullet to protect one another. We see Jesus, the Savior we are following, declare that greater love has no man than this, than he laid down his life for his friends. Pastor John and Pastor Stephen call us over and over during their conversation to John 17, where Jesus intentionally prayed that the church would be protected, that we would be sanctified, set apart for God's glory, and that we would be united. And I am a firm believer that when it comes to unity, Jesus has given us the path in John 17. If we're not willing to protect all people, and we're not willing to call one another to be set apart for the glory of God, there will be no unity. But when we are willing to protect every person on the planet, regardless of their skin color, their gender, their lifestyle, their economic status, you name it, removing all the barriers and willing to love everyone. John 3:16 says, "For God so loved that he gave." And when our world matches God's world, then we can live the way that God would have us and display the love of Christ in a world that is so hurting and is literally dying for this love that Jesus has offered to us. I love how they share change starts in the heart. I invite you to come back next week as we continue to champion how this story ends in Revelation 7, 9 through 12, where people of every nation, tribe, and tongue are united together in worship to Jesus. We see in Revelation 7 that all lives matter. Black lives matter. White lives matter. Hispanic lives matter. Foreign-born international lives matter. All lives matter. So I'll see you next week. Thank you for listening, subscribing, and sharing to Living the Dream podcast.
We're giving away a Starbucks gift card this month to one of our amazing listeners. Go to globalhopeindia.org/dream and fill out the quick free Starbucks form. We will randomly select a lucky listener. So enter now for your chance to win. Thank you for listening to the Living the Dream podcast, empowering and equipping church staff with an identifiable and measurable strategy for reaching internationals and changing the world. You can help us live the dream by liking, commenting, subscribing to this podcast wherever you listen to your podcasts. And you can find more resources to empower and equip your church staff at globalhopeindia.org/resources. That's globalhopeindia.org/resources.